Alright, hello everyone. How are you all doing? So, today I'll be discussing the solutions to Code Forces round 749. It was a combined round of Div 1 and Div 2. And if you've already watched Second Thread's screencast, you pretty much already know how good this round was. So, the problems were well balanced and everything about this round was good. The difficulty levels were again quite linear. Although there was a slight jump between B and C, but anyways, I'll be discussing the first four problems. And let's start with the first problem. So in the first problem, we have an array of size n. And basically what we need to do is we need to output a subset of maximum size whose sum of elements is composite, right? So a composite number is any number which has a factor other than 1 and itself. So we need to output the largest subset, that is the subset having the longest number of elements, and the sum of elements in the subset has to be even, has to be composite, right? Yeah, so that is problem A. Let's just see how to do it. So the first observation here is that if the sum of all the elements of the array is itself composite, then the subset just becomes the entire array, right? That is the first case. And it turns out that if the sum of all the elements of the array is prime, then we can always achieve a sum of composite numbers using just n minus 1 elements. And let's see why is that so, right? So we are at problem A. So case 1 is simple to handle when sum is composite, right? So when sum is composite, you just take all the elements. And case 2 is when the sum of all the elements is prime. So when the sum of all the elements is prime, it means that the sum is odd, right? Because we've been given that n is at least 3. So if the sum of all the elements is prime, it is naturally odd because all prime numbers are odd, right? So the sum is odd. And if the sum of n numbers is odd, then at least one of the n numbers has to be odd, right? Because the sum of n even numbers will always be even, right? So this proves that there exists at least one odd element, right? So now we know that there exists at least one odd element, and our sum is also an odd element. And we know that odd minus odd is always even, right? So we know that our sum is odd, and also there exists an odd element in the array. And if we just subtract that odd element from our subset, our sum will become even, right? So we have achieved the goal of getting an even number, getting a composite number, and we know that all even numbers are composite. So we have got a composite number using n minus 1 elements. And yeah, so this completes the problem. We basically can either take all the elements or we can just remove one odd element and the sum will become even, which is composite, right? So that concludes problem A. Let's just quickly glance through the code. So I take in the input and I calculate the sum of all the elements. Also, I check whether an element is odd or not. If it is odd, then I just store the index of any one odd element. So if the sum is prime, then I know that there exists an odd element. So my odd variable will have an index and it will be storing a valid index. So I output n minus 1 and I output all the elements, all the indices other than this odd index, right? So now I can guarantee that the sum that I'll get is even because I'm subtracting an odd number from an odd number, right? Otherwise, if the sum is itself composite, then I can just take all the elements and get done with it. And this is what does the required job. Right, so this is problem A done. Now let's move on to the more interesting problems. Yeah, so Omkar and Heavenly Tree. Now this is a constructive problem, like there isn't actually much to explain here. You just have to come up with a construction, with a valid construction so that everything works out. The only thing which I'd like to point out is that the way this problem has been framed, it looks rather difficult on the first read that you know that we have been given with three nodes in every query and we need to satisfy that B is not present anywhere in the path from A to C. For completeness, let me read the problem. So first of all, we have been given with a tree and we haven't been provided with the edges. We just know that there is a tree having n nodes and n minus 1 edges. And on top of that, we've been given m conditions. And a condition is of the form of three integers, a, b, and c. And it states that the node b cannot come anywhere in the path from node a to node c, right? So our task is to construct such a tree such that all the m conditions are satisfied, right? So there is no bi which is coming in the path from ci to ai for all I from 1 to n. And that is what we need to achieve here, right? Okay. So another thing to notice here is that the number of conditions is strictly less than n. It cannot be equal to n. And that is the key observation here, which can be easily used to solve the problem, right? So now we know that each of the condition is accompanied by three integers, ai, bi, and ci. And bi is that node which is the node which should not be anywhere in the path from ai to ci, right? And I know that the number of conditions is strictly less than n. So there is at least one node which never occurs as bi in any query, right? So there is at least one node which can which has no restrictions, right? I know that the number of restrictions is less than n, so there is at least one node such that it will never occur as a b in any of the conditions, right? So let's say that I make that node as my root. I know that that node will always exist, and let's say I make that node as my root and try to do a construction from there, right? So observation here is, since m is strictly less than n, there exists at least one node which never occurs as a b in any of the restrictions, right? So let that node be root, right? So I have that node, and I know that such a node will always exist. And now let's see what kind of construction we can do. It's a pretty simple construction, and it comes naturally. If you have solved sufficient level of tree construction based problems, then you would surely be able to do it. So you can form something like a soap bubble kind of structure. So you can do something like this. So this is the root in between, and all the other nodes are just simply attached to it, right? And this is a valid tree because there are n nodes and n minus 1 edges, and all the nodes are reachable from each other. And let's say this is the root RT, right? Now for any two nodes I and j, if none of them is RT, then the path from I to j is simply the path from I to RT and then from RT to j, right? It's just two edges, one from I to RT and the other from RT to j. So I know that RT never occurs as a B, so I don't have any problems. And if one of the two nodes is RT itself, then again I don't have any problems, right? Because I know that RT never occurs as a restricted node, right? So yeah, there is actually no problem in this construction, and we can just simply attach all the nodes to the root, and the path between any two nodes will just contain two edges if one of the nodes is not the root. And both of these edges, I can be assured that they are legal, because the root node never occurs as a B, since the number of restrictions is strictly less than n and the number of nodes is equal to n, right? So there will be at least one node of this kind, and I can just find that node and attach all the other nodes directly through it, and that will form a valid tree. So pretty simple. Let's just look at the code once. Yeah, so I output n and m, and I create a vector of boolean which just stores whether a particular node occurs as b anytime or not. And I can just say for all the b's, root of b is false. And finally, if I find out any node whose root value is true, then that is a valid choice of an RT. And finally, I will always find an RT. So finally, I just attach all the nodes to my root, and I will get a valid tree, right? So this is a construction and just a simple observation based problem. Yeah, so this completes the solution to problem B. I guess now we can move to the next problem. Yeah, so now we have problem C, Omkar and determination. And this is a really interesting problem. So let's see what this problem is trying to say. It is actually pretty hard to even understand. So we have a grid with some cells which are empty and some cells which are filled. And We call a cell exitable if starting from that cell you can actually exit the grid by moving up and left through only empty cells, right? So you can move only up and left, and that too only through empty cells, right? So this includes the cell itself. So all the cells which are filled are not exitable naturally. So that's the condition here. And a grid is called determinable if given only the cells which are exitable, right? We are given the cells which are exitable and which are not, and we can actually determine which cells are filled and which cells are not. Yeah, so a grid is called determinable if this condition holds true. I'll be talking more about this condition later on. So now we have been given a grid of dimensions n cross m, and we need to answer q queries, and each query is given in the form of column 1 and column 2, and each query asks us to find whether the subgrid between column 1 and column 2 is determinable or not, right? So that is the problem at hand. Alright, so in the first read I was not actually able to understand the problem, but the samples are really nice, so they actually help us in understanding the problem. So let's look at what's happening here, right? So we have a grid like this, and for a particular orientation we just calculate whether each of the cell is excitable or not, and we get a matrix of this form, right? We get a matrix for every orientation, right? So this is the orientation and this is the corresponding matrix, and a submatrix is determinable if and only if the matrix of E and N that is formed by this particular submatrix is unique, right? I guess I said the opposite. So basically for every submatrix there will be a matrix of E's and N's that will be formed. Let's call this matrix M2 and let's call this orientation as M1. So for any value of M2, if there is a unique value of M1, then I can say that that particular M1 is determinable, right? So here this is M1 and this is M2, and indeed for such a M2 this is the only possible M1 we have, and that is why this M1 is determinable. Similarly for this particular value of M2 we can only have this particular value of M1, so this is also again determinable. But if you notice in this subgrid the answer is actually no, because for this particular value of M2 we have a lot of different options of M1 to choose from. One is this particular M1 and other is this particular M1, right? Both of these values of M1 give the exactly same value of M2, right? Because all of these cells are not excitable, so, and that is the case in both of these M1s, right? So we need to determine whether a particular M1 is determinable or not, and so that is the problem. And to begin with the solution, let's make some observations. So first observation is that if a cell is filled, then it is always an N in its M2 form, right? So if I am converting an M1 to an M2, then if a cell is an X, then in the corresponding M2, it will always be an N, right? But if a cell is not filled and it is a dot, then in its corresponding M2 form, it can either be filled or, I mean, it can either be an N or it can be an E, depending on whether it is excitable or not, right? Yeah, so that is the case here. So now let's look at it in the opposite sense. For any M2 which is an E, the corresponding entry in M1 has to be a dot, right? Because we know that all the filled cells are not excitable. So in any M2, if there is an E, then the corresponding entry in its M1 form will be a dot. But if there is an N, then the cell can either be an X or a dot, right? So that is the main observation. If we get an N in an M2 form, then basically the answer will be no, because we no longer have a unique value of M1, because in that particular entry of M1 we can either put an X or a dot, because it might be possible that an empty cell is not excitable, and it is always the case that a filled cell is not excitable. So an N can either be an X or a dot, and that is actually the main observation here, right? So let's try to write things down. Problem C, and let's start with some observations. So I've already defined what the M1 and M2 forms are. So in M2 form, if there is an N, if there is an E, then its corresponding entry in m1 will always be a dot, which is unique, right? But if in m2 form we get a n, then in m1 form it can be either an x or a dot, right? So that is the solution here. So this second observation is actually giving us the hint to a solution. We just need to form the m2 form from the m1 form, and in the m2 form if we find an n, then we know that the m1 form will not be unique, right? But the only catch here is that we need to forget about whether originally my cell was filled or not, right? Yeah, so I need to forget about whether originally my cell was filled or not, and that just means that in this line it is written that it includes the cell itself, right? So all the filled cells are not exitable. But I rather don't make that assumption. I will assume that I can start at any cell, and once I am starting from a cell, then I need to figure out whether it is exitable or not. So basically I am just forgetting whether that cell is an X or a dot, and I am blindly starting from it. And if that cell is not exitable, then my answer is going to be no, because in my corresponding M2 form I will have an N which can have either a dot or an X in the M1 form. So the M1 form is no longer unique. Right? So that's the solution done. You just forget about whether your current cell is a dot or an X, and you find out whether it is removable or not. And if it is removable, then if it is exitable, then you are good. But if you find at least one cell which is not exitable, then the answer is going to be no, and that is the solution. Now the only question which is left to answer is, how exactly do you optimize the solution to find a cell which is not exitable in our subgrid, right? Because at the end of the day, we need to answer queries, and the number of queries is up to 10 to the 5, right? So we need to find a way to quickly answer our queries, and to do that, we'll have to make some more observations, right? Firstly, I'll write the most critical observation, that is, if I find, so after ignoring the state of the starting cell, if I find any cell in the current query subgrid which is not exitable, then the answer will be no. Otherwise, the answer is going to be yes, right? So that is the most important observation to make here, and the only question which remains now is to optimize it, and let's see what happens, right? So when do we actually come to a situation where we cannot move? And that situation is just when we have an X to our left as well as to our top, right? Because from anywhere we can go one row to the top or one column to the left, right? And if both of these places are an X, then we are stuck. And that is the only situation where we are stuck. Otherwise, we can just keep moving and get out of the array, right? So let me call a cell which is illegal if and only if it has an X to its left as well as to its top, right? So let's call cell I comma j illegal if s of I minus 1 and j is equals to x, and s of I j minus 1 is also equals to x. So an illegal cell is the one where after reaching it I won't be able to move, right? And if we carefully observe, a cell is not reachable if and only if after making some steps a cell is not exitable if and only if after making some steps I arrive at a cell which is illegal, right? The only condition where I'll stop is when I reach an illegal cell. So really what I want to know is whether in my query subgrid there exists at least one illegal cell, and if there is so, then I'm done, the answer will be no, and if that is not the case, then the answer will be yes. And another thing to note is that I don't have to include the first column of my subgrid. because from the first column I can obviously just move to the left, and all these cells are just exitable if I forget about the initial state, right? So in my query I have values x1 and x2. So in the columns from x1 plus 1 to x2, if there is any illegal cell, then I'm done, right? Yeah, so that is the solution here. And the number of cells which are illegal in a particular subgrid can easily be found with prefix sums. We can use 2D prefix sums, but that is not really needed because we don't actually have any subgrid. The number of rows are actually n for all the queries, so even a 1D prefix sum array will work. And let's just look at the implementation for better clarity. Yeah, so here we go. First of all, I am forming a vector where aij is 1 if the string at that position is capital X and it is 0 otherwise, because it is just convenient for me to use vectors instead of strings, right? And finally, that I know that all the cells in the first row and the first column are legal, so I don't really check them. And for all the other cells, I check whether the cell to the top of it and to the left of it are both 1 or not. If that is the case, then I do something. And let's see what I'm doing. So I'm making a prefix sum array, and here psum of j denotes psum of j is equals to 1 if there is a cell, if there is an illegal cell in the jth column, right? And 0 otherwise. Right, so yeah, that is what I'm doing here. So if aij is illegal, then I just say that psum of j is equals to 1, and finally I just construct this cumulative sum from going from 1 to n and adding prefix sum of I minus 1 to prefix sum of I, right? So after I have completed this step, now my prefix sum of j denotes the number of columns from 1 to j which have at least one illegal cell, right? So after I take the cumulative sums, this is what my prefix sum is representing. So it is representing in the prefix from 1 to j how many columns are actually there which contain at least one illegal cell. And finally I will get an L and an R, and I need to find out if there exists any column in L plus 1 to R which has an illegal cell. And this quantity can be found from p sum of r minus p sum of l. And if this quantity is greater than 0, then my answer will be no. Otherwise, the answer will be yes. And that is it. That concludes the solution to problem C. So again, it was an interesting problem. And in the contest, I actually complicated it a lot, and I ended up using segment trees. There is also a very elegant solution using segment trees, but later I realized that that was just an overkill. And this solution is actually much easier to understand. So yeah, I won't be discussing the segment tree solution here. And yeah, so this concludes problem C. Let's now move to the next problem. Right, so now we have problem D. This is an interactive problem. And so if you guys want to know about interactive problems and you haven't really solved them before, or in general you need to practice about interactive problems, I actually have a video which is specially dedicated to interactive problems, and I'll link to it in the description if you guys wanna have a look. Anyways, so right now let's see what this problem has to say. So the name is Omkar and the meaning of life, and it turns out that the meaning of life is a permutation p1 up to pn of integers from 1 to n, and we need to figure out this permutation. As always, we have to do in an interactive problem, we need to find out what the permutation is, and of course we'll have to make certain queries and we'll get some results. And I'll define a query formally. So in a query, we give an array to our interactor, and this array is not required to be a permutation. It can be any array, but all the elements have to be from 1 to n as it is written in the constraints. And finally, we have the permutation, and the interactor knows what the permutation is, and I'm providing the interactor with an array of my choice. And finally, what the interactor is doing is it is adding the corresponding elements of the array which I provide and the permutation. And finally, it is getting sj equals to pj plus aj for all j from 1 to n. And finally, what it is doing is it is finding the smallest index k such that the element at the kth index in S occurs more than once in the array S, right? So if there is any one index k such that sk occurs more than once, it will straight away output k, and it will output the k with the minimum value. And if there is no such k, then it will output 0. And finally, using at most 2n queries of this type, we have to find out the permutation, right? So in the problem, I don't know why they actually gave us 2n queries. So the solution that I'm going to be discussing today is using at most n queries, or maybe it is using exactly n queries and it is just saving n queries. I don't know why they put the query limit to be so sensitive, but anyways, so let's discuss a more efficient solution which uses just n queries. So again, this is just an interactive, constructive problems, and if you just figure out the construction, it is actually not that difficult. Let's see. So first of all, let's see what happens when I do a query of a following kind, right? So I will see what happens when I query like this. So if I'm querying something like this, 2 2 2 2 2 2 2 2 up till n minus 1 times, and finally I have 1, right? So this is my query array, and if I query something like this, let's see what will happen. So I have I have p1 p2 p3 p4 up till pn, right? So my S array will finally be as p1 plus 2, p2 plus 2 up till pn minus 1 plus 2 and pn plus 1, right? Okay, so I know that all the elements in the permutation are unique. So all the elements in S from 1 to n minus 1 will be unique, right? Because they are just p1 plus 2, p2 plus 2, and all the p's are unique. So all these elements are going to be unique. So the only possibility of finding a duplicate is between the nth element and any corresponding element from 1 to n minus 1. And let's say I find a match in the ith element. So then I will have pi plus 2 is equals to pn plus 1. Right? And that just means that pi is equals to this is irritating. It is outputting the value of pi by itself. Anyway, so this just means that pi is equals to pn minus 1, right? So this is what we get by querying like this. And now let's see what happens if we query something like this. So 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, and 1. So we can make a similar argument and say that pi plus 3, for if we find a match, then pi plus 3 is going to be pn plus 1. Which again implies that pi is equals to pn minus 2, right? And I can just keep doing that, right? And finally, I will get to a situation where the query output will be 0. So according to the problem, if there doesn't exist any match, then the query output will be 0, right? And that just means that in the entire array, so if the query is like this, k, 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 and 1, and I get 0 as an output, then let's see what that means. So in case of 2, I was getting pi equals to pn minus 1. In case of 3, I was getting pi equals to pn minus 2. So in case of k, I will be getting pi is equals to pn minus k minus 1. And this is the first value such that the answer is 0. So that means that this has to be 0, right? Because I know that it doesn't exist, and all the elements from 1 to n are existing. And if I know that this value is not existing, then it has to be equals to 0, because it is the first ever value. And I'm going down from n to n minus 1 to n minus 2 up till 0, right? So this has to be 0. So that just means that I have successfully found that pn is equals to k minus 1, right? So I have utilized pn amount of queries, right? So first query will give me pn minus 1, then pn minus 2, and from pn minus 1 I am going down to 0, and in actually using just pn queries I am finding just one element, which is pn, right? So using pn amount of queries, I have found the last element of the permutation. Right, very good. But what we realize is we have not just found pn, we have actually found other values as well. We have actually found all the values from 1 to pn, right? Because the first query is giving me the index of pn minus 1, the second query is giving me the index of pn minus 2, and so on and so forth. So this means that using pn queries, I have found the location of all elements from 1 to pn. And I know what pn is, right? Now the only task which remains is to find out the location of all the elements from pn plus 1 to n, right? And it turns out that we can do that pretty similarly, right? So with this thing done, let's see how we can find out the value from pn plus 1 to n, right? So previously we used queries like this, right? 2, 2, 2, 2, 2 and 1. Let's see what happens if we use queries like this. So as you can see from my code, I have used queries like this, I plus 1 and 1, and then I'm using 1 and I plus 1, right? So what I'll do is I'll keep all these elements as 1 and the last element will be 2. Then I will query all these elements to be 1 and the last element to be 3. And I just duplicate all that. So let's see what is actually happening in queries of this kind, right? So in this query, what is happening is if I find a match anywhere, obviously it has to be from the last element to any of the first n minus 1 elements, right? So if I find a match at pi, then I will get pi plus 1 is equals to pn plus 2, right? So that just means that pi is equals to pn plus 1, and that means I have successfully found the location of pn plus 1. And similarly, this will mean pi is equals to pn plus 2, and this will mean pi is equals to pn plus 3, and I can just keep doing it, right? And similarly, if I just keep doing it using n queries, I will find all the elements from 1 to n. So in the first pi queries, I am finding all the, in the first pn queries, I am finding all the elements from 1 to pn. And after that, when I figured out what the last element is and I figured out the location of all the elements which are smaller than the last element, I can just use the remaining queries to find out all the elements in the range from pn plus 1 to n. And in total, I'm just using n queries and I have actually solved it, right? So let's just have a look at the code. So as always, I have made a query function, and I will always recommend you to make a separate query functions in interactive problems. It makes your code much less messy, and I have also made this function which prints the answer. It just makes your code cleaner. Otherwise, the code for interactive problems can get quite messy at times. Right, so what I'm doing is, first of all, for all I from 1 to n minus 1, what I do is I query something like this, which is 2221, then 3331, and so on. So basically, for the first n minus 1 elements in my vector, I push I plus 1, and then finally I push 1. And I look at the result of the query. If I get the result as 0, then that means I have found all the elements in the range from 1 to pn, and there is no element smaller than I now. So that just means that pn is equal to I, right? So here we found out that pn is equals to k minus 1, and here this I is just k plus 1, right? So I can just say that answer of n is equals to I, and I'll break out. But if that is not the case and I'm actually getting the location, then I know that for I is equals to 1, I am finding pi minus 1. For I is equals to 2, I am finding pi minus 2, right? So I just temporarily put a minus I in the position of res, right? And finally, when I will find out what the value is at the nth location, I can just say that the position at I will be just answer vec at n and add it to the temporary value, right? So I'm just adding a temporary value of I whenever I find a location which suits, and finally I can just add that temporary value to answer vec of n, and that will just do my job. So I'll be repeating this. So as you can see, when I is equals to 1, I'm finding pi minus 1. When I is equals to 2, I'm finding pi minus 2, and so on, right? I mean pn minus 1 and pn minus 2, and so on. So finally, I just create a temporary vector which stores these temporary values. And once I figure out what the value is, what is pn, I can just add pn to this temporary value, and I will get the locations of all the elements from 1 to pn. Now with that sorted, I will just query things like this, that is 1112, 1113 and 1114. And in a similar fashion, I can get all the locations of elements which are from pn plus 1 to n. And finally, I just output the vector as the required form says. And this completes the solution to problem D. So I won't be discussing any more problems today, because from here onwards, the difficulty is increasing a lot. And so this is all for today. I hope you guys got to learn something new. And thank you for watching till the end. Bye bye.